IVM.
Hi everybody, just wanted to ask everyone for a quick favor. We're running a brand survey right now and would really appreciate it if you could let us know what you think about the advertising on IVM. Go to ivmpodcast.com/survey and do let us know. As part of this, we'll be selecting 10 random participants and sending them some IVM swag, so do fill out those surveys.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast supported by Pragati, a flagship media initiative of the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like to bring fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and an Indian perspective to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to another episode of All Things Policy, where we discuss policy issues of importance to help you make sense of all the news that you read. My name is Priyaldi Almeida and I work with the research group at Takshashila Institution, focusing on health and life sciences. Now, the concerns over waning immunity and SARS-CoV-2 variants have convinced some countries to deploy extra vaccine doses. Ruturaj and I will discuss about the third dose, the booster dose, in light of Pfizer getting permission to start doling out the third dose of its mRNA vaccine. On 4th of August, the World Health Organization called for a moratorium on boosters until at least the end of September. The World Health Organization has strongly objected to rich nations giving a third round of shots when poor countries don't have enough vaccine for their first. Though the moratorium was against implementation of booster doses, various countries were conducting studies to figure out the efficacy of the booster dose, and we will eventually get to this during this episode. So to begin with, what I actually want to ask you, Ruturaj, is what exactly happens at the cellular level inside the body with a booster shot? Now, is it just another shot? And if it is another shot, why don't we simply call it a third dose or a third shot? Why do we specifically call it like a booster shot?
Yes. So the reason we are calling it the booster shot is because in the first two instances, in terms of COVID, the first two doses are going to mount a primary immune response in the body. What I mean by primary immune response is that antibodies, specific antibodies against this COVID, won't be involved because the body is encountering this virus for the first time. So it doesn't have these specific antibodies. So it's going to be a very different kind of a slightly general response, a primary immune response against these cells. But once this primary response is over, there is the formation of a memory immune cells, especially B cells, memory B cells. And what the booster dose is doing is it's going to challenge these memory B cells to get rejuvenated and come and act against the infectious agent. In this case, it's going to be an attenuated virus or the mRNA of the virus. So what is happening in this booster shot is that, as the name suggests, it's giving a boost. It's not the first time the body is encountering something. It's the second time. I mean, this time the body is sort of prepared. So what is happening is the memory B cells, which were already formed due to the during the first two instances, are going to start multiplying. They're going to start producing antibodies specific to this virus, in this case, the SARS-CoV-2. Another process that is happening during the booster, affinity maturation. So what happens is that these B cells, which were already produced during the second instance of infection, would reach the lymph nodes, the lymph system of the body. Here, they would again encounter the virus, viral particles, and this will be the second time they are encountering. And this second encounter, especially at the lymph nodes, will start a process that I alluded to before called affinity maturation. What this is basically at the broadest level is fine-tuning of the antibody structure against the bacteria or virus, respective infectious agent, because each B cell would be dedicated against a particular virus or a bacteria. This repeated encounters would lead to the fine structure of the antibody becoming more capable of targeting and precisely binding to the infectious agent. So for subsequent events, in the near future or even in the distant future, the binding would be even faster, tighter, and more specific. So the booster dose is not simply a third dose. It is leading to fine-tuning of antibodies, and it is involving a slightly different subset of immune cells. So a booster dose does have a role in protecting a person from diseases. The body is learning and becoming better at dealing with infections.
Right. And the thing is, like, the term booster shot is like very familiar to Indians, right, with respect to like neonatal vaccinations. For example, for the Japanese encephalitis vaccine, or as well as like the first dose of the injectable pentavalent vaccine, which is given to the baby when it turns around 6 weeks old or 1.5 months old. And it protects against the 5 diseases against which this vaccine provides protection. And this includes like diphtheria, whooping cough, tetanus, hepatitis B, and influenza. And even like at 2 years when the typhoid booster dose is given. So as such, the term booster shot is not a foreign concept to Indians. Now, given that they know what exactly booster shot means, what exactly could be the potential side effects? Because we know that when people took the first dose of the COVID vaccine, or even for some people during the second dose, they had some amount of side effects in terms of a fever, body ache, headaches, and stuff like that. So with the booster dose, are we thinking of like, do you think there will be more severe side effects, or are the side effects going to be less severe? What exactly do you think is going to be?
Yeah, you're exactly right. The term booster shots, booster doses is nothing new. India implements a lot of vaccination programs. Our neonatal vaccination programs are pretty robust. And it's the same concept as boosters that we encounter with typhoid or the pentavalent vaccine. So it's the same. We are just thinking of adults in this particular scenario for COVID. Now, coming to side effects, it's an answer. It's a question that we don't have any definite answers. And why I say that is that if you see the side effects that people all over the world had were very varied. So there are a few studies, but nothing is conclusive, nothing that worth quotable. So I would, this is, so what is coming up, what is apparent is probably the booster dose will also have certain side effects. They would probably be the same as what a particular individual suffered in the first two cases. There is really no way to comment on the severity, whether it will it be more or less severe. So I would like to leave it at that. But yes, there will be some side effects. That's it.
Okay. So now that we've understood what exactly the booster dose is and stuff like that, do you know of any countries that are thinking of giving booster doses to their population?
Yes. So there are quite a few countries which are thinking of implementing the booster doses. These countries are like Germany, Israel, UAE, China, Russia, all have been thinking about this. Some governments are actually running programs, especially the UK. It is the case of UK is slightly interesting because what it is thinking is it's a booster trial where they are thinking of giving the booster shot. The booster shot will be of a vaccine which would be different from the first two doses. So what the logic behind this commissioning of the study is that different vaccines are of course targeting different areas and different aspects of the disease. So if we have another vaccine that the booster dose comes from a different vaccine, maybe it's going to offer far more broader and robust immune response and protection. So UK is conducting studies on that manner. The US, of course, was waiting for the moratorium, I could say that. But in early August, they have sort of gotten the permission. Israel on 29th July announced that people over 60 years would start getting the booster dose. Israel uses the Pfizer BioNTech vaccine. This is the same that the US also uses. And what the UK plans to do, it plans to give booster doses to people over 50 years of age, and along with other people with certain high risk groups. It could be because of one's profession, that like they could be frontline workers or certain long-term diseases. So yes, many governments, many public policy institutions in various governments are coming up with different strategies. And if you observed, these are mostly rich countries. So they have more or less finished vaccinating their at least adult population. And now the discussion, the discourse in these countries is moving towards the booster dose.
Thank you for the response, Ruturaj. We will be taking a short break and we will be joining you back in some time.
Intel vPro provides the complete manageability tools to detect, repair, and protect your devices remotely, so your workforce can keep doing what they do best, wherever they're working from. Today, as most employees and IT teams no longer work under the same roof, fixing glitchy PCs and proactively managing the PC fleet has become increasingly difficult. The Intel vPro platform addresses these problems with its Intel Active Management technology, Intel AMT. vPro enables IT to keep mission-critical resources running by establishing a secure connection between IT and an Intel vPro platform-based PC. In the event of a cyber attack, Intel AMT lets IT remotely manage and repair systems simultaneously, even if they are dispersed across multiple locations. PCs can be recovered quickly, wherever they may be. Plus, the Intel Endpoint Management Assistant, Intel EMA, enables cloud-based manageability using simple web-based tools to connect with and remediate any Intel vPro platform-based PC. Both these tools provide better manageability and faster response times, resulting in substantial device management support costs, saving, and fewer help desk tickets. Visit intel.in/itheroes to know more. Intel vPro, built for business.
Hello and welcome back to this episode of ATP. Continuing with our previous conversation, we know that there are certain countries that have been thinking about moving to the booster doses. Has any country currently done, have they employed using booster doses for their people? Has anyone done it yet?
Yes, Priyal, UAE has actually started implementing the booster dose. So what they did was Sinopharm, that is a Chinese vaccine. And this vaccine was an inactivated vaccine. But what UAE now is doing is they have started using the Pfizer vaccine, which is the mRNA vaccine, as a booster shot. China also is doing something similar. They plan to use they plan to produce the mRNA vaccine and then use it as a booster for people who have got inoculated with the inactivated or the protein-based vaccines. It seems that people are thinking of mRNA vaccines, that's why the Pfizer vaccine's appearance gets more news, as a good booster candidate for their citizens. So as far as I have, my reading goes, UAE and China have sort of started doing this to a certain extent. US booster vaccination would pick up pace now that the CDC has cleared the Pfizer one. And UAE, I'm not sure about when UK is about to start, but they have already drawn up a plan for over 50 years of age. So I would like to guess that UK would also start soon.
Right. Like you said earlier, that the US seemed to have been waiting until the moratorium was lifted. And now that CDC has recently given approval for Pfizer to carry out the vaccination. So can you tell us more about this, Ruturaj? And also, I would like to, can you tell us more about who exactly is eligible to receive this vaccine?
Yes. So the way CDC has gone about is pretty logical and straightforward. What they have said is that, of course, people who are above 60, they are going to get this vaccine. But US is not, at least for now, is not thinking of, you know, combining boosters. It's going to be 60 people over 65 years of age who had been inoculated with the Pfizer vaccine before. That is, they got the first two doses of the Pfizer vaccine. Only these people are now eligible for a booster dose of the Pfizer vaccine. There is no mixing and combination like other nations are thinking of. The other category of individuals is people who are above 18 years, that is mostly like all the adults, but with medical conditions like, you know, cancer, pulmonary diseases, severe diabetes, chronic kidney disease, also women who have just delivered or are pregnant, even they have been cleared for the booster dose of Pfizer, provided all these people had the first two doses. Had received Pfizer's first two doses. The second category is, of course, frontline workers, irrespective of age and other complications. They have been cleared for the booster dose. Apart from Pfizer, Moderna and Johnson & Johnson, booster doses also have been cleared, but this is only for people who are immunocompromised. And in this criteria, of course, the cancer people receiving cancer treatments have been included. People who had received an organ transplant or on active immunosuppressants are in this list. So are people with certain rare genomic diseases like DiGeorge syndrome and Biscuit-Aldrich syndrome, which lead to immune deficiency. These people have been are part of this, as well as people who are HIV positive and have a low CD4 count, and people on long-term medications, especially high-dose steroids for a variety of conditions, which leads to immune suppression. All these have been added especially for the Moderna and J&J. So I will just, to summarize, Pfizer for 65 plus and people with other conditions. But in case of Moderna and Johnson & Johnson, only people with really severe complications in the immune system, especially like people who are taking long-term steroids and organ transplant patients. And so that's the scenario in the US. I will end here.
Yeah, right. So now, given that, like, you know, so many countries around the world are considering or even moving towards booster doses, what do you think India should do? Should India employ booster doses to its citizens, or should we not? Like, what do you think we should do?
Yeah, I would like to begin this answer with a quote from Dr. Balram Bhargava, and he's the Director General of Indian Council of Medical Research, ICMR. So in a recent press conference on 17 September, what he said was, I'm quoting him, like, administering booster doses is not the central theme at the moment in the government's scientific and public health care discussions, and getting fully vaccinated with two doses remains the major priority. So what the Indian government is seeing is that right now, we definitely are not going to start doling out the booster dose. And that makes sense because we still have to cover vaccination of our adult populations. We have not completed that. After that, the children and Indian children would probably be cleared for this. And then or probably when the booster dose for really vulnerable people might start along with the children's. But right now, the government has clearly stated out that they are going to focus on getting the second dose out for all its population, all of Indians. And that this you know, it makes sense. It's completely understandable. We still have the booster dose, though I can understand, is useful for vulnerable people. But considering how the disease spreads, we need to think of the entire population. So the second dose should get a priority. And then once that is done, maybe the booster dose for really vulnerable people can be implemented with vaccination for children. Now, this sort of, you know, echoes what I'm saying is, I'm echoing a discussion document that Takshashila had regarding the different types of age groups and different types of individuals depending on the profession and who should get the vaccine. So I think something similar framework can be even applied for the booster dose, like people with 65 years with and other people with such diseases or Indians who have just received a different organ, or people suffering from HIV, AIDS and other such diseases, they should be prioritized for booster dose after our second dose is completed. So I can understand why Dr. Balram Bhargava made such a statement. We have to sort of prioritize depending on the available vaccines. And would like to again like quote another person. It's Divyer Aron. He's from Israeli Institute of Technology in Haifa. Like, what he says, it's very interesting. It's very succinct. So what he says is that the risk is low and the advantage is high. So the risk of implementing booster shots is low and the advantage is high. So if we are thinking whether not to implement this or not, I don't see any problem because the risk is really, really low and the rewards, especially for vulnerable people, high. Provided we first cover the second dose, then we can definitely serve the booster dose. So I don't think this is that the conversation regarding booster dose is sort of a no-brainer. It definitely is going to be useful, but only after we have covered everyone with the second dose.
Right. That actually makes sense, right? Because It's better to have entire population vaccinated with the first and second dose and then think about a booster dose rather than jumping into a booster dose now and then leaving a certain part of a population with neither the second dose nor the booster dose. So thank you so much, Anturaj, for this conversation, and thank you for being here. This is Priyan and Rituraj signing off.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst. Or our website, takshashila.org.in.
Hey everybody, it's been a great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On The Longest Constitution, Priya narrates the long and ongoing battle of striking down Section 9 of the Hindu Marriage Act of 1955. That allows one party to appeal to the courts to restore his or her conjugal acts, and has unsurprisingly been used more by men than women. On Press Decode, Bhagda, Ragini, Sarah, and Adya talk about the inspiration behind the movie Hotel Rwanda. Venkatesh Saha, head of APAC and Middle East Expansion at Wise, joins Anupam on Paisa Vaisa to talk about foreign exchange services. And on The Life Manifesto, Zarina explains the difference between personality and personal brand. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any of our other shows for that matter, please do tell a friend. It really does help us. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors on the network this week, Cred, Bank of Baroda, Quarter, CoinSwitch, Kuber, and Intel vPro. Thank you so much for making this possible.
If you love cricket, listen up. The Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast is here for you. Hosted by DJ, Varun, and me, Ashwin, we bring a fun, fresh, fan's point of view to talking all things cricket. Sometimes it's just the three of us, sometimes we have guests, including current and former international cricketers. For new episodes every week, check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast on the IVM app, website, or wherever you get your podcasts.